Okay, our next speaker, Professor Ishida, so please.
Okay. Oh, thank you. To unify this, we have the theory of the Kreevsky representation, and by that, we can ask we can answer to these questions. Phi, these are topological, and that means once the flow is irrotational at the beginning, it maintains to be irrotational if you consider some ideal evolution. And similarly, if the flow is initially 2D incompressible, it will continue to be 2D incompressible. And also, if the initial flow is helicity free, it will be maintained. So I'd say that that is a topological property of the flow. And we can show why these properties are topological. That means invariant throughout the ideal evolution. And so then we can consider how these topological constraints influence the turbulence, in the inertial range. So these topological constraints will give some influence to the turbulence that I'm going to discuss. So the background of this talk is the first, there was a suggestion by Fukumoto that these topological constraints can be unified as cross helicities. And this is the one essential idea. And also, I will draw heavily on this the work, collaboration with Phil Morrison. And that means the hierarchy of flow field parameterization. And that hierarchy means, you know, that we have these kind of special type of flows as a hierarchical structures. The outline of my talk is I'm going to say that the Kreevsky parameters are fundamental field underlying fluid observables. So I'll explain why I'm going to consider this. And fundamental means we can consider The canonical Hamiltonian mechanics in Kulebsch parameters, phase space. And that is not directly visible, but we consider some canonical Hamiltonian mechanics of Kulebsch parameters. And we consider that the fluid observables, like densities, you know, the entropy or the velocity field, they are reduction from these Kulebsch parameters. So that I'll call reduction to fluid variables. And then for on the this visible fluid mechanical parameters, we can construct fluid mechanics equation just from the canonical Hamiltonian mechanics of Kulebsch parameters. So that is the basic idea. And this reduction means the degree of freedom is reduced. And so therefore, this reduction is, in some sense, the redundant. And that redundancy allows us to consider some gauge symmetry. And this gauge symmetry will give you the so-called Kashmirs as net charges. And it is also well known that helicities and these kind of things are the net charges. So the Kashmirs can be regarded as the net charges of this the gauge symmetry of the reduction. And so that means the Kashmirs basically describes the fluid mechanics is constraint. And that constraint gives some constraint mechanics as the fluid mechanics. And so that is the geometrical picture of topological picture of the fluid mechanics. And we can formulate generalized entropy, which is conserved in 3D ideal flow. You know, the generalized entropy is usually assumed that it's a constant of motion of 2D flow, but we can show, we can formulate a further generalized entropy that is conserved in 3D ideal flow. And this generalized entropy basically reflects the circulation law, but it is more convenient to delineate the topological constraints in the 3D ideal flow. And so this generalized entropy may put obstacle in the way of cascade because it's the constraint, topological constraint. So in the inertial range, the fluid motion is topologically constrained by this generalized entropy. And this generalized entropy degenerates into the conventional generalized entropy in the 2D fluid. So therefore, we know that in a two-dimensional situation, the inverse cascade occurs. So then the question is what happens in the 3D, because in the 3D, usually, we never pay attention to the entropy. However, we do have somewhat similar to the entropy in the 3D vortex dynamics. So then, in the 3D, we show that the vortex tube stretching gives the path for the cascade. So that is the expression. Explanation of the difference between 2D and 3D. So I'll start from reviewing the Hamiltonian mechanical formulation of fluid mechanics. That is already well known. So to avoid the complexity induced by the boundary condition, we just consider three-dimensional torus. Neglect the boundary. And consider the ideal flow obeying this. And by ideal, I mean inviscid and barotropic. So this is a barotropic pressure. And so this is, the very well-known equation for the fluid mechanics community, most simple. And so then we can put this in the Hamiltonian form. Hamiltonian, but it's the infinite dimension Hamiltonian form. And to do that, we first define the phase space. And naturally, we consider this rho and v as these are the fluid observables. This span the phase space. So we consider the phase space of rho and v rho is the density and v is the velocity, right? And then we can put these two equations into the Hamiltonian form, which I avoided to write down here. It is very well known. And we can formulate non-canonical Poisson bracket. And the energy is just simple fluid energy, Hamiltonian. And then we can write it in a Hamiltonian form. And because the Poisson bracket of this Hamiltonian mechanics turns out to be non-canonical or the degenerate. And the non-canonicality is reflected as creation of the Kashmirs. And the Kashmirs are the constants of motion. There are two. One is the total mass, and the other is the fluid helicity. And these two are known to be the Kashmirs of this the Poisson algebra. And these are the constants of motion of in the context of physics, but in the context of mathematics, these are the center of the Poisson algebra or the Kashmirs. And Kashmirs are the constant of motion, but it is very interesting in the sense that is independent of the choice of the Hamiltonian. And usually, in the physics, we believe that the constant of motion is some attribute of some symmetry of the system. So usually, the constant of motion comes from the symmetry in the Hamiltonian. However, these Kashmirs are independent of any choice of the Hamiltonian. So the origin of these Kashmirs are not in the Hamiltonian, but it is in the symmetry or the some gauge symmetry beneath this the fundament, beneath this the fluid variables. So the idea is we may relate this Kashmirs as the gauge symmetry of the Poisson algebra. Okay? So then the question is, what is the more fundamental field beneath the fluid variables? So there are any kind of mathematical possibilities, but I'm proposing here that the Kreisky field is the fundamental field beneath the fluid mechanical variables. So we can prove that by formulating canonical Hamiltonian mechanics on the Kreisky parameters, and then by reduction, we can reproduce fluid mechanics. So that is the scenario. So here, we introduce the Kreisky parameters as the underlying basic quantities. And that I write like this. Here, we invoke six functions like this, rho, phi, p, q, r, s. And so these six component functions, among them, rho, p, r are three forms, and phi, q, s are the scalars, zero forms. And three form means something like the density, okay? And scalars are just scalars, like, you know that. So these are the three of them are three forms, and three of them are the scalars. And we define the canonical Poisson bracket, just canonical like this. And this JC is a canonical symplectic matrix. So we formulate canonical Poisson bracket on this phase space. And then fluid system, the previous fluid system is obtained by relating these Kreisky parameters to fluid variables like this. Rho, density is this Cauchy rho. I put star for to become a rigorous mathematically, but star means a Hodge dual. Hodge dual means basically that you divide by the volume form. Okay, so, and then velocity v is written like this. And this is the well-known Kreisky parameterization in some part more mathematical representation, but we writes that, you know, that these are the fundamental Krebs parameters appears as this, and law and velocity in this very specific form. And then we may write the Hamiltonian, that is the fluid energy, and the fluid energies, of course, are the sum of the kinetic energy and thermal energy, multiplied by the density and integrate over the volume. Okay? So because this V, this part is a velocity V, so this represents the kinetic energy, and by this epsilon, I'm representing the barotropic thermal energy. And just plugging in this the Hamiltonian to the previous canonical system, we obtain this Hamilton's equation of motion. And that reads like this. And you will find that only the equation for phi is a little bit complicated, but four others have very similar form. And you will notice that, for instance, this is nothing but the mass conservation law, right? And that is law, as I said, is a three form. So this means that the law is redrug as the three form. So it is maintained if you integrate over the commoving volume. And others, P, R, these are the scalars. These are QS are the scalars. That is just also redrugged as the scalars. And P, R are the three forms. So they are just, you know, the constant of motion along the flow of motion. So therefore, the Hamilton's equation of motion is very simple. And it says that basically that these, the Krebs potentials are accepting phi, are just, you know, the transported by the flow. Okay? And using this, then we can easily verify that, you know, the relating rho and v in this way, we can easily check that this equation of motion is equivalent to the fluid mechanics equation. So therefore, we can say that these Krebs parameters, Hamiltonian mechanics of Krebs parameters is the fundamental representation of the fluid mechanics. Yes? Yeah, phi is the Bernoulli constant, from here. It's basically the energy density. Okay, so for the Krebs parameterization, we have this kind of lemma that says in the n-dimension base space, we can represent every one form. It's something like a vector. In this form. So this is the Krebs one form, which we call Krebs one form. That is special because this first component is exact. It's just a gradient of something. And others, you know, the general way. So we can say that in the n dimension, every field is written like this. So therefore, in the two-dimension space, every velocity field can be written like this. And in the three-dimension space, every field can be written like this. So you notice that we need another RS pair in the 3D. In 2D, this is enough. And even in the 3D geometry, we can consider what we named epi two-dimensional flow that has only this component. So we can consider this kind of a special class of flow in a 3D space. And we'll show that this is the Helicity-free flow. Okay? And in a 2D geometry, two-dimensional geometry, as I said, every velocity field can be written in this way. So therefore, the phase space is a little bit smaller. We need only P, Q, and we do not need R, S. And then we have in a two-dimensional fluid mechanics, we have the so-called generalized enthalpy as the famous constant of motion, and that is written like this. And F is an arbitrary function, and we basically divide the, this is the so-called potential vorticity, and any function of potential vorticity multiplied by the density 2,4 gives you the constant of motion. And you can easily verify this is a constant of motion. But here, that we notice that the basic point is in a 2D, vorticity is always 2,4. It's the curl of the velocity. And velocity, if you consider velocity is a one form, curl V is that omega, the vorticity is a 2,4. So if you divide 2,4 by 2,4, you get a scalar. So the idea of formulating this is you first determine the scalar field, and then you integrate over multiplying density, you get this constant of motion. So we can do the same thing in the 3D. So in the 3D, we have this generalized enthalpy conservation. So how we can formulate the generalized enthalpy is for the flow, by taking a curl, we have two components contributing to the vorticity. First one comes from the first component of the Clebsch, which I denote by omega plus, and the second one comes from the second component of the Clebsch that I will denote omega minus. And for each omega plus and omega minus, we can formulate this as the generalized three-dimensional enthalpy. And to define that, we need another commoving redirect scalar, sigma. And by help of this redirect sigma, we can formulate this. And we can show that this generalized enthalpy is a constant of motion in the 3D. And this sigma, to define this, may be any commoving scalar field. And that may be either phantom or actual. By phantom means that any scalar field which does not enter the Hamiltonian, and actual field, I mean that some field entering in the Hamiltonian. And in a two-dimensional case, this sigma may be simply the coordinate, perpendicular coordinate z. And then you can easily show that this collapses to the conventional enthalpy. But for the 3D, these are the generalizations. Okay? And also, it is interesting that that you can create fluid helicity by this, just combining these two generalized enthalpies. So we will call this generalized enthalpy as charges, topological charges. And so therefore, these are the more fundamental topological charges than the fluid helicities. So the fluid helicities are just a combination of these two generalized helicities, enthalpies. And topological constraints given by this. Okay, so we now notice that even in a 3D, we have topological constraints given by these topological charges. So that any ideal flow must conserve these topological charges. So in 2D, as I said, it collapses to the conventional enthalpy. So therefore, it is known that this, and also if the flow is almost incompressible, the conservation of this charge is the conservation of omega. So therefore, the omega cannot change in the 2D. So therefore, the slow change, because this is the constraint, the slow change of this omega in the Fourier space by the action of this convection blocks the cascade of the energy. So the energy cascade is blocked by the slow conservation, topological constraint imposed by this. So therefore, the energy must go to the other direction, so the inverse cascade occurs. So this is the well-known scenario. So what happens in the 3D? In the 3D, fortunately, the conservation of these two charges does not directly influence the magnitude of omega plus and omega minus, because that was the multiple of the gradient sigma and this. And this gradient sigma is basically the perpendicular direction. So therefore, if this gradient sigma is reduced, this omega may increase. So this is the well-known vortex stretching, because the decrease of the variation of sigma means, you know, the elongation in the direction of sigma. So that means the stretching can help to omega to be cascaded much, much faster than the usual situation. Okay, I'm finishing. So therefore, the vortex stretching paves the path for the normal cascade. And this is the how this, you know, the stretching will modify the you know, the omega. So I'll skip this. So let me conclude. So invoking the Kreviche parameters, we can formulate a canonized fluid Hamiltonian system. And we have topological charges, that is the generalized enthalpies, whose conservation poses the topological constraint on the 3D fluid motion. And the well-known helicities are the derivative, is the derivative of these the charges. And in 2D, that is the topological charges, the generated enthalpy conservation gives the inverse cascade. In a 3D, the vortex tube stretching enables rapid cascade of omega, enabling normal cascade. This is, of course, well known. But the point is, this omega plus minus invariance faces morphological constraint on the cascading process, because these are the topological constraints. So by use of these things, we can make more detailed analysis of how the cascade will create the internal change of the structures in the fluid. So thank you very much.
Okay, thanks. Any questions?